machines can't think as people do. A machine is different.
Well, thanks for having me over. I had a fantastic flight over from Gustavus. We got to go over the mountains, and as everybody knows, the spring is just crazy early. And I was scanning the south-facing hillsides all the way up at 2,000 feet, looking for goats in these bare hillsides. Somebody just told me, Lou said that he's been hearing the hooters here. The hooters have been going in Gustavus. I heard my first varied thrush yesterday. Anybody heard of varied thrush yet? And of course, the juncos have been going off. So this early spring, it can be spooky, but it's also just fantastic to get a jump on this concert that pours into our lives every spring. And since I've started recording, I've come to appreciate that spring, that concert of spring bird noises more and more, and how brief it is and how quickly it shuts down. You know, by the end of June, July, it's pretty much show over. The birds they're busy feeding their young. So that late May, early June window is now the weeks of the year that both Richard and I wish we could be in about 8 different places at once. But anyway, this is my office, which has got to be one of the best jobs on the planet. For the last 2 years, Richard and I have been under contract with the Park Service at Glacier Bay, building a library of sound. And this spring, we get to jump up to Denali and play on the tundra. And we've got, so that early June primetime window, we're going to be camped on a flat area of the park, tundra, ponds, winding rivers, lots of nesting ducks, and loons and cranes, and there's willow bushes, so there'll be the warblers will be there. But I'm most excited about the shorebirds, because we get a lot of shorebirds moving through here, but on their nests, they sing. They fly and sing, and I've just heard the recordings. I've never got to be there and listen myself. So I've got, if the bugs don't drive us crazy, we're gonna have a great trip up there this spring. I typically don't show pictures when I do a talk about sounds, because we're so visual that it's hard for us to really open our ears when there's a pretty picture in front of us. But I decided to show just a few today to give people a little bit of a sense for the work. And I brought some of the toys too. So this is the getup. This is what I'll look like until about, end of June. So think of a moose, right? Or a deer. They've got big parabolic dishes. And you watch a deer, and if it's looking at you, and it's decided it's gonna leave, it'll turn around. It'll turn both those things around, and it can turn them in different directions. So it's got these exquisite parabolic dishes on its head, and so we pack them around. And these things enhance our hearing to about what a deer can do. And I had when I first got this thing. I took it out. It was about this time of year, and I just went out and I was playing on a beach, and there was a deer down the way, and I just started sneaking on it and listening. And you can control the amplification through the digital recorder, and I had it turned up to 7 on a scale of 1 to 10, and I got to within maybe 70 yards of that deer, and I could listen, and I could just hear it foot go down and break brittle ryegrass. And you take the headphones off, there's no way you could hear that. And then I decided to get a little bit closer. I took one more step and my foot crunched a dead alder leaf. And that deer snapped up and looked at me. So at 70 yards, that deer could hear that one little leaf go. So it was a fun little window that when my digital recorder's on 7, it's a little insight into the deer's world. And there's no way those deer don't hear us coming in the woods. When we get close to them, it's not because they haven't heard us. It's because they just haven't run away yet. And the centerpiece of this thing is something I didn't bring with me. It's a very expensive, exquisite microphone that fits in this little foam thing, and you know, just like our satellite dishes and everything, this just amplifies the sound. But that's the spendy piece of the whole unit, so it's back in this little box at home. And this is Richard, and this is another one of our toys. There's two microphones in there set up to record in stereo. And he's just got that strapped to the boat, and he's just listening through the mics. And when he hears something cool, he can just reach down and hit the record button on that recorder. So this is a great way to record a harbor porpoise. You just wait for one of these things to go right by the boat or harbor seals. And this day, this is up in Glacier Bay, and we just had a flood tide take us back into Adams Inlet. For those of you who have been back in there, it's just an exquisite place loaded with life. And with the tide pulling us, we didn't even have to paddle, so we didn't even have paddle noise. So we got a bunch of great recordings that day. And the sound, the Glacier Bay bears spent a lot of time eating barnacles and crunching mussels, so it was a sound we really wanted to get. And we didn't get it this day, but there's another day where a pair of bears let us get close enough to get a great sound of barnacles just being ground by bear molars. And when we're in heavy bear stuff, Richard's turned me on to these bear fences. So that's just, that's our mobile office. So we spend a lot of time recording big sounds like these guys and these guys. But mostly what we do is go after sounds of critters you can't even see. And that's the birds. And that habitat right there is the reason Glacier Bay is such an exquisite place for sound. If you go all over Southeast Alaska, birds are all about bushes. So the diversity of birds you're going to find in the old growth is nothing compared to the 1.5 million acres of alders in Glacier Bay. If you look at a Google image of the park and you get a sense for how extensive that alder patch is, and if you go anywhere in that alder patch from sea level to 1,000 feet in June, you'll be an earshot of a half a dozen different species. And you just start to think about the number of birds in that 1 million acres of alders, and it's just mind-boggling. So it's just a huge landscape and we're just listening to a teeny piece of it. We spent a lot of time listening to these guys rumble and crack. Here we're working semi-palmated plovers in an Otwash fan. I have no idea what he's recording there. But whatever we're doing, it's just a damn lot of fun. So we work out of my boat. This is my skiff. And if the water's calm enough, we can actually record from the boat. But if there are ripples this big, we can't record because it's an aluminum boat and waves that big, they're just tapping the boat and it's just too much for the microphones. But we'll just stop and we'll both just scan. We spent a lot of time trying to get good recordings of kitlets, murrelets, which there's a lot of them in the bay. And they're quiet. They're an evasive bird. So we spent, I don't know how many hours chasing around, but we just stopped the boat, listen, and then try and get closer to them. And a lot of days like that, just walking willow bushes, where, of course, that's where the birds are. And here we are probably listening for murrelets. And just all this beautiful country. And I got to take my family with me on the recording trips. And this is the bear that let us get close enough to record Crunch and Barnacles. So again, that's my office. And this is a small enough group. If you guys have questions at any point, just go ahead and shout them out. I don't have any kind of set program tonight, so please feel free to jump in.
How about that bear fence, that electrified one?
Yep.
Does it work?
I never got bit. Richard's seen it work. The idea is they have to put their nose on it. So they have to lead with their nose. That it doesn't have enough juice to, if they're just gonna push into it with their shoulder, it's not gonna go through all that fur. And the other variable is how moist your ground is. So if you're in really dry sand, the bear's not gonna be grounded enough.
What's the pack weight on that?
Oh, it's next to nothing. It's actually powered by 2 C batteries. And you just clip it on the line, and the whole thing, there's 4 stakes and that's a wire. It all wraps up and it goes into a bundle like that. And we only set it up when we were in, when we were camping in a spot we probably shouldn't have been anyway. But Richard's used them a lot up in Katmai and other places where they're just, the bear density is really high. And he's seen them from a distance work. You know, he's coming back to camp. He's watched a bear come off of him. And in that photo, you'll see little pieces of orange surveying tape. And that's just a visual to get the bear focused on the lines with the hope they'll put their nose on it. Oh. It does hurt, though. You can't camp too many nights around that thing before you get zapped. Oh yeah, you know, you're getting up in the middle of the night to take a leak and there's an electric fence right there that wasn't there the night before, and anyway. It hurts. So these sounds, we had 2 years to build this library of sounds for the Park Service. There's a copy of that database that sits at Bartlett Cove, and its primary use is for the interpretive staff. So they have, whatever, 20 seasonal interpreters that get on the cruise ships and do their thing. And they show up each spring to build their slide programs. They've got a library of digital imagery, and now they've got a library of digital sounds. So you can search this database by species, by habitat, by date, whatever, and pull up these sounds. And my hope is that guitar music on slide programs will become a thing of the past, and we'll do our presentation set to the music of the place itself. And I love guitar music, it's hard to beat the music of the place, and why not take advantage of it? There's another copy of the sounds in Ithaca, New York, with the Cornell Library, the Macaulay Library of Sounds. They've got the biggest library of natural sounds in the world, so we were in partnership with them. They've got them all cataloged, and they're actually available online. So you can go to their website and type in any species you want, and they've probably got a recording of it.
What places, like how long do you spend at your work when you work? How long do you usually do in an average day?
Our day starts at about 3 in the morning. Peak, during that June window, the peak bird sound starts about a half hour before sunrise and goes for maybe an hour, hour and a half after sunrise. So we wake up to catch that. And it's also the time of day when there's not very many boats around. There's not many planes. There's one plane that must be coming from Anchorage to Juneau at 5. And it must be a freight run. So we gotta stop when that thing goes over. But there's not very many fixed small planes around. So our day starts at 3. We're usually eating second breakfast and taking a nap by 9. And that morning window is often quiet in terms of wind, because wind, rain, and motors shut us down. So everything's got to line up for good recording. And then the rest of the day is just opportunistically, if the conditions allow, we're recording. So we're always listening, but we get a lot of time where the wind comes up and we're just sitting against a beach log waiting. So we wake up early, but honestly, we don't work that hard. And we'll spend the rest of the day moving camp, and we'll set our tent up in the place we want to record the next morning. So we just figure out what animal we're going after, what habitat have we not recorded yet, and we just go set up camp. So we're there for a prime time at 3 in the morning. So this is Adobe Audition. It's the software we're using. And I'll just play a couple sounds. We'll do a name that song. We'll start it on easy. Oops. And see, I didn't have this turned up because we're in a library. Can you guys hear that okay? So these guys just showed up in big numbers in the last couple days in Gustavus. They're not singing yet though. Anybody know who that is? That's American Robin. Yep. So you could record that same bird in New Jersey and I probably wouldn't recognize it.
Really?
So it's really fun. And you can do this by just going onto the Cornell website, pull up American Robin. They'll probably have 500 recordings of Robin on there. And you can just play them across the country. And it's amazing how different they are. Actually, just going up to Denali, there'll be birds that I'm very familiar with here, a fox sparrow. I won't recognize it when I go there. I'll have to relearn it. All right, we'll do a really easy one. All right.
So the not recognizing, is it like a dialect or is it a totally different pitch?
It's a dialect. Pattern? Yeah, especially a complicated song like a sparrow. There's a lot of variation, even in birds right next to each other here, but they're close enough that, you'd recognize it. So I'll go to the tundra and I'll recognize that's a sparrow, but I don't know what it is. So someone will have to tell me, or I'll have to go and look at it to start training my ear. And even, as these birds start up again this spring, I'll have to relearn just because it's been so long since I've heard them. Some of them, especially the harder ones, I'll have to relearn. But the great thing about birdsong, and I've done this with the school kids in Gustavus, is, you know, starting in about February, I go in, I start playing songs for them. And I introduce them birds in the order that they're going to hear them in the spring. And so we'll just start, and we'll do four birds until they got them. Then we'll add three more, and then we'll add three more. And then by the time school's out, they've got, you know, the 12 to 15 birds they're going to hear behind the school. And we'll start going out now, and it's easy. The only bird singing is a junco, and it's a really simple song. And they know what bird's going to come on next. And so they got them. And I could play jingles off of the television or the radio, and we'd all know them. You know, so our capacity to recognize sound is just innate. And you can pick up your phone, and you can hear two syllables. Hello? And in those two syllables, you'll know who you're talking to, if it's a person you know, and you'll even know something about their mood. You'll know something about how their day's been. So there's so much embedded in sound, and we're just wired to take in information. But we've fallen out of practice somewhat with the natural sounds. But we have the capacity, and I'm living proof for it. I've been here. I grew up in Juneau, been in Alaska all my life, and not until I really started this project did I take the time to learn and pay attention to this concert that's happening right outside my door. And I had a great teacher, Richard. He knew all the birds, and he was very patient with me, and he'd tell me again and again and again. And I started to get them. And kids, of course, are better. I mean, they're better with foreign languages. And when I watch these Gustavus kids grab these songs, they're just quick, way quicker than I was when I started to work at this. All right, here this is not a bird. So that's a sound unique to Glacier Bay, and if you wanted to hear it here, you could probably hear that at the Mendenhall Lake. It's icebergs. It's air that's been trapped. So, you know, the snow comes down, and there's air between the snowflakes, and the snow keeps coming. It compresses it, and those air bubbles get trapped in the ice. They calve. And as they're melting in the lake or in Glacier Bay, those bubbles are breaking out of their ice. So if you could capture that air, it's a couple hundred years old. And not all bergs are that talkative. So we interviewed a lot of bergs to get that particular recording. So we just motor around and listen. But most of them do talk. So this was right behind my house in Gustavus. Oh, that's too quiet. So I think there's four or five different animals. Nuthatch? Raven? Squirrel? Raven? So maybe it's just those four. Well, it was just the four. It was the nuthatch. Is it? I'll just play the nuthatch again. All right. Here's a fun one. You got it. Oh, here's a fun one. You got it. That's a good. Not many people get that. There's a harbor seal. Good job. So as well as just going after individual species, we do soundscape level recordings where rather than using this dish, which ends up being really directional, you can, you know, if you're after that bird up on that branch, or you can't even see it, but you know it's up there, you know, if you point it up here, you'll hear a little bit of the bird, and it'll get louder and louder. And then you go back and forth, and right when you're aiming right at it, the sound just pops, and you get all this detail. And the challenge with this, and the first year I was doing this, I ruined almost every one of my recordings because that microphone's so sensitive. It picks up creaking tendons in your wrist, and Richard listened to my recordings and said, "Man, you got a bad case of palsy or something." But you just have to listen and you hear it. It's kind of a deep rumble, and you can't change the pressure of your grip, and you can't move. And if you want to track something, you got to turn at the hip, because if you use your shoulder, it'll the tendons in your shoulder will get picked up. So I trashed about 3-4 months of recordings before I finally learned to have a light touch with this thing. I think Richard kind of enjoyed that because his recordings were all so good. I gravitated towards those open mics, which you just put on a tripod, and you're not aimed at an individual critter. You're just getting this broad open.
Can you isolate? So if you set up one of those open mics and you get a sound you like, can you isolate that sound?
It's hard. It's hard. Yeah, there are, and there was a guy, Bernie Krause. He's been doing sound work for a long time. He came to Glacier Bay in the 70s, and he did some open recordings like that. And he's now sent me those recordings with a Latin long and a date and a time, so I can go back, set a mic up in the same place, and re-record. And so it's like a time-lapse photo. Yeah. Like it's doing a photo station, taking a picture every year for 30 years, 40 years. And especially in a place like Glacier Bay where the vegetation is changing that much, you would anticipate that the gray-cheeked thrushes that are now singing the upper bay will be replaced by Townsend's warblers and Swainson's thrush. So it'll be fun to go back and re-record. So there is a demand for those, or use for those. So as well as individual sounds, I got into doing things like just the sound of feathers. Those are just chickadees at a feeder. So that's fluttering, it's just their little teeny wings. And you can hear them scratching in the seeds. Well, there's the buried. Hummingbird, and again, I just put that microphone right by the hummingbird feeder. I've got a long cable on the mics, and I just bring it inside, especially in the springtime. I just have those mics on in the house, these things on, the mics are out in the yard as long as it's not raining. So I'm doing the dishes or whatever, and oh my God, there's white-fronted geese going over. And I can hear them, they're at 500 feet. So it's a great excuse to not finish the dishes. I get to go outside and watch the geese go over. Or the hummingbirds, like, oh, there's the first hummingbird. I just heard it zing through the yard. So you can put these up, and you don't even have to have the headphones on. You just plug them into your sound system, and you just bring all that sound right in the house. You know, I remember when I built my house in Gustavus, I was really slow because I didn't know what I was doing. So I spent a lot of time in that house just framed up with no windows. And it was fall time, and I finally stuck all the windows in. And it was actually a really sad day. It just felt like I just built myself a prison. And I just locked out all of that sound. And so now I could be warm and bring the sound in. This is a fun one. This recording I was in Dundas Bay, spring migration, and the shorebirds were just pouring in. They were just actively landing by the hour, filling up the mudflat. So I had the recorder down by the water, and I was probably, 200 feet away, sitting in the ryegrass. So the first thing you'll hear is just the shorebirds. Oops. Do you hear that sound? That was a hawk. That was a hawk that just came over my head and right over the mics and into the shorebirds. That was a sharp shin. So again, just think of all the different sounds made by feathers, right? So we just heard a chickadee, a hummingbird, and a sharp shin hawk. So we of course have a list of our top sounds, which will keep us outside as long as we can walk trying to get them. And top of that list is that sound made by a peregrine. And I'm sure a lot of you have heard that. You know, the first time I heard it, I thought, now what is a military jet doing over Admiralty? It sounds so mechanical. And I was actually fishing for cohos in a stream this fall, and I saw the peregrine come up the river, and he disappeared. And next thing you know, I'm hearing that sound. He's just ripping down. He's chasing a gull right in front of me, and all I had was my fishing pole. You know, I didn't have my dish, so I've heard it like 3 or 4 times, but never with the mic on. Yeah, it feels like you've been strafed. Yeah.
So. I was wondering, do you have a variety of owl recordings?
Yep. Gustavus is actually a great place for owls. We got saw-whets, short ears, northern pygmies, boreal. Actually, I just saw a boreal owl last week. Barred owl, great horns. They're all there. And there's actually a pair of barred owls that's already setting up nesting, and they're making all kinds of noise right now in Gustavus. I just heard them yakking a few days ago. So what else we got? The other great thing about getting into bird song here is we don't have that many birds. We've got 5 warblers, and warblers are tough, but we've only got 5 of them. So you want to learn birds in Georgia, the warblers would just sink me. But we've only got 5 warblers. Sparrows are a little bit hard. We've only got 5 of those. And thrushes, robin, swainsons, hermit, gray cheek, and varied. We've only got 5 thrushes. So you don't have to learn that many. Let me show you another important tool. Somewhere in here. Well, anyway, for you guys, it's going to be your iPhone. For me, I don't have cell reception, so I just have this thing, which is a phone that does everything but make phone calls. And the app is iBird. Do people have that? And the cool thing about iBird is it's got all the sounds on there. And so this is actually with me when I'm recording, and it's going to be a key piece of equipment when I'm up in Denali with birds I don't know. So you can grab a recording with your phone, and if you've got iBird, you just toggle, you figure out what is this? Is it a warbler, is it a sparrow? And you can just toggle back and forth and play the sounds off iBird to help you ID what you got. And they keep updating it with recordings from different places. Because again, if you're listening to a bird here and Cornell has offered up a New Jersey recording, it's not going to be that helpful. Which is interestingly part of why the Park Service got interested in this is Richard did some work in Gates of the Arctic. There was somebody up there who was doing bird counts. They were surveying birds just by sound, and the woman was trying to train her staff, and all she had was commercial bird recordings, and they didn't work for the Gates of the Arctic birds. So she hired Richard to go out and build or just to capture the voices of the birds of that place. We were at the radio station today, and we got to talking about settings. So the equipment's great, but the thing that really makes a recording outstanding is the amphitheater that it's in. And you need a theater of varying dimensions depending on what the sound is. So if you're after the prime loon recording, if you can get into a quiet cove that comes to a point and it's got like a wall of spruce trees and it's maybe 200 feet across, if you can get a loon singing right there, you'll get that echo. And if you're after a thrush, you're going to want to just the spacing of old growth trees is about right. And if you're after a whale, you need something that's a couple miles across. So here's a whale recording that was calm water, so I could record from the boat, and there was bedrock cliffs about a mile and a half apart. So listen to the echo in this recording. Still echoing. So, you know, there's just a whole bunch of luck that has to line up to get an animal in just the right spot. Here's another name that tune. Not that. There's a squirrel. This sound gives it away. Close. Beaver. That's a beaver chewing and another beaver slapping his tail. And there it is chewing again.
Did they know you were there when he was making that sound?
Richard got that one. I wasn't there.
Because I was on a run the other day and we ran past a beaver pond and a beaver, I think we scared him and he started slapping the pond. And it was the first time I'd heard him, seen him do that. I didn't know if he was letting us know he was there or if he'd been doing it the whole time.
I think it is an alarm thing of probably letting other beavers know, you know, something's up. So this was a recording made right from the house in Gustavus. Again, we probably left the house at 3 a.m. and we both went different directions. And we're coming back, I don't know, 6:30 a.m. and we're just coming back to get a cup of coffee. And we're just standing outside the house. So the first thing you'll hear is just how many birds are singing in early June when this recording was made. And you just forget how alive this place is with sound. But then you'll hear what happens. Listen to that. So that was right from the house, which was a sweet treat.
Is that a wolf?
That's a wolf.
Do you ever record any wolves on
Admiralty? I have not, but I haven't, you know, I don't spend but a couple, 3 days a year on Admiralty anymore. And so listen to this wolf recording. In that last one, the birds were front and center with a wolf in the background. And this is an exquisite wolf recording. And the wolf is front and center, but after having listened to this thing for a couple hundred times now, what really makes it for me are the birds. That wolf was probably 50, 60 feet away.
How come the last wolf recording showed up at like one level of pitch and this one shows up at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or however many lines?
Yeah, isn't that interesting that that you can see the harmonics
right.
Of that wolf.
And the other, is it just how close you were? Because the one in the prior recording...
Yeah, you're just not getting the detail.
Okay.
Yeah, and so it's all about getting close, and it's true with birds too.
See, now that sounded too like it was more towards the middle of the day, like late morning.
That was probably 6 a.m.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that almost had the sound of the birds was actually more like a sun-baked sound? They've been out, they've got their thing, they're just making.
Well, it's that wolf was laying in the ryegrass out on a gravel point.
Uh-huh.
So it wasn't prime bird habitat. So you hear a savanna sparrow in there. You hear these beach birds. And there's a gull that clucks in there at one point, and you can hear little waves hitting the sand. And the other one, the Gustavus one, it's a real mix of habitats. There's spruce forest and willow bushes and open meadow. So real diversity of birds in that other one. And I, Richard again got this one, and I was down the beach in an alder thicket recording all kinds of birds and giving blood to the mosquitoes, and he was out on this point getting this thing. I wanted to show you one more thing. So this is a hermit thrush. And if you look look at this, and then you just visually scan down this and try and find the next one that looks just like it. It's like right here. So let's listen to this bird, or that note. You hear, oh, there's a whale. You hear all, that's just identical. And then listen to how different this one is. So this next one's going to start and go up. So you can, with the help of the software, you can learn to see how many different variations they have on that same song. So you could assign a letter. So here we go at A, B, C, D, E, and you get back to A right there. And listen again, and in between this one, there's another bird singing right here that's farther from the mic. Hear that? So those two birds are singing off of each other, and you know, if somewhere else we're getting a nice clean recording of that bird, and when this bird starts high and goes down, this bird's going to start low and go up. And the two birds are going to have the same number of variations, but they're just playing off of each other. And if you figure out, all right, a Glacier Bay bird's got 9 variations on that song, and you go to the East Coast, you'll find hermit thrushes may only have 6. So there's just that much variation within the same species across geographies. And if you just go from Glacier Bay to Sitka, you'll find differences. So it's just endless once you start digging in and paying attention. How rich it is, all the stuff going on out there. You're raving. You know, I've often thought I should record nothing else, that I could spend the rest of my life recording ravens, and I have spent a lot of time. I've got a bunch of ravens just right in the front yard. And just to go around Alaska and record ravens and to start to document and learn to recognize the dialects and the language. And we've got ravens that nest nearby. And so you got this cacophony of those young birds screaming at you. And you can literally listen to them learn to talk. Just like little kids are doing that proto conversation, they're just babbling. Ravens will just sit, these young ravens will just sit and just play with their voice and make just endless sounds and just discover sounds. So I've got recordings of a 6-week-old, newly fledged raven just sitting there on a branch for 20 minutes playing with its voice. And then it's got you know, it's going to live for 30 years. It's got 30 years to keep working on it. And you just go to different places and they've learned all kinds of different stuff. Again, so I'm just going to Denali, the ravens will be saying all kinds of different stuff. So I think I'm going to wrap it up, except for any questions. Well, I a few days ago, I said, well, we got to jump in the boat. Let's go to Dundas. Let's go get in the middle of spring migration. I had to remind myself it's March. You know, the shorebirds are not going to show up. I mean, maybe they will.
Wait, the other birds are showing up?
Yeah, I did see a new flock, but... peak of shorebirds last couple years has been first week of May. We're a long way from the first week of May. But I don't know. I'll just keep listening, and I'm sure enjoying the sounds now.
Do you ever play back the songs to the birds?
I haven't done that. I've been really tempted to. And I've been wanting to get a decent portable speaker, but you can, I've done some just with this, and this works. You'll bring a bird closer and get them excited. And some birds really respond, like kitlets, murrelets. They'll come all the way to the boat, and there's been researchers putting transmitters on kitlets, and that's how they're catching them. They're just playing their call, and they're getting them so close, they're grabbing them with a dip net. And that's after we spent 2 years trying to get close to them. So
I've spent a lot of time kayaking and come across big flocks of scoters, and they fly and make this noise, and I've never understood where the noise comes from.
That's wings.
It's wings.
It's wings. I think I might even have that dialed up. It turns out those guys... don't talk. The Cornell lab has a most wanted list of sounds, and surf scoters and white wing scoters are on there. And I said, oh, this is easy. We'll be heroes. We'll record these guys. So I can't tell you how many, how much time I spent interviewing rafts of scoters that just do not talk. But when they take off, that's all wing whistle. And golden eyes make it too. When golden eyes take off, you'll hear it. And then once they get their airspeed up, that wing whistle tends to mellow out.
I don't understand what makes the noise. Is the wind going over wings?
Or through feathers, yeah. And again, it's just another one of those crazy sounds that feathers make. And I don't think I have that dialed up right now, but I do have another crazy... I mean, listen to this. So that's a snipe, that whoo, and that is made, so when you see them, they're over their nesting territory and they're flying up, and the sound's made and they're coming down really fast. And they've got stiff feathers on the backs of their legs, and they're fanning the air past those to make that sound. So there's another sound that feathers make. And I don't know why scoters and golden eyes whistle when they take off. The sniper doing it, it's their version of song. They're attracting mates and defending territory. And I haven't been able to train my ear up yet, but people who have a really good sense of pitch can ID golden eyes and scoters based on the pitch of that wing whistle. Yeah, I don't have that dialed up. Oh, yeah. Oh, there's another wing sound. I love love that sound. And that's actually not a raven, that wing sound. That was a magpie. That's a little fast for a raven. So any other questions? We need to break in case anybody's going to see that 7 o'clock movie.
Let's thank Kate. That was amazing. Thank you.
Well, thanks so much for listening, and you got all spring to keep listening.